Hey friends, today on the podcast, we're talking electric vehicles. And joining me from Consumers Energy, Lauren Youngdahl-Snyder. She is the Vice President of Customer Experience, and I cannot wait to get into the conversation. My guest today, VP of Customer Experience, Lauren Youngdahl-Snyder. Lauren, how are you?
I'm good. I'm so excited to be here today.
I am so excited to talk to you because EVs or electric vehicles has been something I've been fascinated about since they rolled out in the market. And you've been driving one for a while. So I'm wondering, before we kind of get into how we should think about it as consumers, what got you interested in, and what has the experience been driving an electric vehicle?
You know, I was really intrigued by these vehicles. And there have been a few friends of mine who always like to be the early adopters and had purchased electric vehicles before they became kind of, you know, a big topic like they are today. And they really were struck by the performance of the vehicle, the look of the vehicle, and this whole idea that moving to an electric vehicle could play an impact on the planet. And so I jumped in to figure out what this is all about. And I knew that there obviously is a connection to our electric industry, which I'm a part of, our utility industry. And so I wanted to firsthand understand what this would look and feel like so that as we started to get more involved in this space, I could speak from firsthand experience. And so I have an electric vehicle. I have a charger in my garage. I went through the installation process. I went through the purchase vehicle experience, and, you know, really, I have found it to be a great vehicle. My husband is in the market right now. He's looking at a couple of different options, more of like an SUV look. I have three little kids, and so we're trying to figure out, like, okay, how does this become something that supports our family? Which, so we're trying to, we're looking at those options, but I just think of, you know, how much advancement has been made over the last few years and the way that the battery technology has advanced, this whole like range anxiety that was something that I worried about, you know,
I'm on
the road a lot, especially before the pandemic. And I was worried, like, I don't want to get stranded. And I learned that that's not the case. And I also learned how just easier it is to have an electric vehicle. Like, I don't have to go to the gas station. I don't have to worry about maintenance upkeep like I've had to with other vehicles. And so I think the performance of it, the look of it, and knowing that it's making an impact on the environment in a really positive way, really were the key reasons why I was thinking about it and why I like driving an electric vehicle.
And I would say one of the most surprising things for me outside of all the things you've already gone through was just how different the ride is, how quiet.
Oh my
God. You don't realize how much rattles when you drive around in a traditional car.
It's crazy. You almost are like, why is it so quiet?
So we're feeling like we're at a bit of a tipping point with EVs. And I'm wondering if you could maybe put some shape and form around how Michiganders should think about electric vehicles.
Most definitely. You know, I think that even since January, we've seen so many different headlines that suggest EVs, it's not a matter of if EVs are coming, it's when they're coming. So I think about GM's all electric ambition by 2035. Or the release of the Ford Mustang and the Ford F-150 Lightning, which I think is going to be a special game changer within our service territory. I think about the battery technology advancements. In the 2022 Tesla battery pack, it will take 7 minutes to charge. So from zero to full, 7 minutes. Like, it takes me longer to go to the, it would take me longer to go to the gas station, right? And then I think about just the policy changes that we're seeing at the federal level, where President Biden and the U.S. Senate's infrastructure bill has really put a stake in the ground of, we want to have a network of national chargers. We want to have, we want more vehicles on the road. We want thousands of electric school buses on the road. And I know that the state, our state is very ambitious in the way that we think about sustainability and clean energy. And we are the auto capital of the world, are we not, Michigan here? And the auto's commitments as a part of that kind of state commitment that I know that they're working on, you know, just suggests that there are EVs will hit the road and they're going to be here sooner than I think maybe we would have ever projected, even looking back when we started the programs at Consumers Energy. There's been just so much advancements, and we're excited to see what's to come now and in the future. So for Michiganders, I think, you know, some people will say range anxiety, right? Like I said earlier. Well, and I'm going to talk about our programs, but people should rest assured that over the last few years, there's been a very concerted effort to make sure that we have proper charging infrastructure. You can drive, got to do my Michigan hand, might be backwards on the screen, but you can drive from Bronson, Michigan, all the way up to Mackinac City on chargers that have been rebated through our program. You can also go west to east as well. And we're working too with other states to make sure that people who travel to Florida, we're part of a coalition now, that so those who can drive from Michigan to Florida, which we know that happens a lot. There's many of us.
Maybe it happens a couple times, I think.
That we're working in concert with those states, and the same from east to west. So we really want to mitigate that as a concern. The other thing people will say is, well, it's really cold in Michigan in the winter, and that will impact my battery. It does. You know, I noticed that too. But with the battery technology just getting better and knowing that, yeah, impacts it by a few miles. I mean, on average, you get around 200 to 300 miles on a full charge. And most of the time when you're charging, it's at home. Seriously, like 90% of charging takes place at home. And so anyways, those are some of the things, I think the signposts that Michiganders should, I'm no doubt have read in the headlines, but should know that there's a great concerted effort between our OEMs and our utilities and the state and the federal government to really make sure that adoption of EVs is seamless.
Lauren, you said a couple things in there. One, I read an article last week about the busing, and if we switch the busing to EVs, what an impact that would have on the environment. But the other thing specific to Michiganders is you'll hear this a lot, is this idea of power. Can the battery have as much power as a combustible engine? And you see Chevy and Ford entering into this, both with trucks that can pull up to 10,000 pounds. And I'm wondering if that will be, you know, you've seen Ford have to double their, you know, forecast for what happens with the Lightning when it finally comes out next year. And I'm wondering if you think, like I do, that those two trucks are going to be a big deal, especially in this state, with adoption rates.
100% agree with you. And I think it's the vehicle style and like the choice of that vehicle that's appealing, and to know that it can be run on a battery and it can, it's an electric battery, like it's electric, just is the melding of two great things, right? So I think it will be a game changer for our customers to know that there are options. I mean, by in the next couple of years here, we're going to see over 240 different vehicle choices.
Wow.
Which is amazing.
And that's been probably the most amazing thing, is all of these OEMs that you've probably never heard of in the combustion space are now putting out EVs, and you're like, I've never heard of that company, but here they are making hundreds upon hundreds of vehicles.
Exactly. Yeah. So there's going to be great vehicle choice, which I think is really exciting.
Now, one of the issues that we've been hearing a lot in the news is this chip shortage that prevents cars from being made. And that is butting up against President Biden's, you know, next 10 years, 40 to 50% of the cars sold in the United States to be EVs. Your point of view from consumers is that attainable with these shortages and the supply chain issues that we're having right this very second? Because although you and I might think some days 10 years seems like a lot of time, we blink and 10 years is over. And I'm wondering your thoughts about hitting that goal.
I do think, of course, today it has impacts, but it will be resolved, right? And we are looking at a time horizon that is at least 10 years, right? And so I do think, of course, there is going to be challenges every year, no doubt, from different types of sources and reasons. And so I still believe that despite that, we will see these ambitions achieved through these autos.
Obviously, Consumers Energy is doing a lot of work in that space, and I want to talk about all of it. And I want to start with Power My Drive. Can you explain to people that maybe don't know somebody who has an EV or don't have an EV, kind of the work that you guys are doing with Power My Drive? And then I want to talk about Power My Fleet as well.
Sure. So Power My Drive is really a program for our residential customers. And the way that this works is Once you purchase your electric vehicle, we provide a rebate for that charger that you're going to install. And we also help navigate the upgrade of service and make sure that you, that because a charger, right, like the in-home solution, we want to be helpful in helping navigate that. And so it's a rebate for chargers. It's also not only just in the home, but at workplaces and public locations. So as I mentioned earlier, this kind of footprint of Michigan and our L2 and DC fast chargers, we worked with Michigan State University. This started a couple of years ago to really think about what's the right strategic placement of charging stations. And working with them, we have our foot, you know, we know what the footprint looks like, and we've strategically worked with several partners across the state to bring to life these charging stations so that whether you're home and you're charging or you are on your way to, you know, to visit another part of the state, that we've got the proper infrastructure set up. And so today we've got nearly 200 chargers in our network that have been rebated Wow. through our program with an investment plan to do more of that. So that's the Power My Drive. Power My Fleet, we just launched this in May, and this really is a concierge service for business customers who want to convert their fleets to all electric. And it also includes rebates for charging stations and infrastructure upgrades. And this is fascinating to me. Like, to me, this is another signpost that EVs, it's not if, it's when. We intended to have around 20 customers enrolled by the end of the year. And today we have over 50 in our queue. Like,
wow.
And it's a whole range. It's a mix of industries. It's a mix of size, you know, companies who have a few delivery vans to those who are looking at converting their entire fleets. And what I think is unique about this program is it's a white glove service offering. We are working with you to help you understand how, like, what's the math on this? Like, what has to be true to make this work for your business? We published a report based on, you know, working side by side with you that says, here are the impacts and here's how we would make that conversion. And then we work with them to get the charging station, get the rebates, get it all set up. The other piece I would add too is we have a time of use rate. We call it our super users rate. And so when you're charging, which again takes place typically at night, it's a super reduced rate. So there's an incentive too that helps offset any kind of cost that might be a concern. So Power My Fleet, like I'm just thrilled with the demand that we're seeing from customers. And then the other thing I'll note too, we want to be able to walk the talk internally. So with our own fleet, Consumers Energy Fleet, by 2030, we intend to have 100% light duty vehicle purchases, all electric. And total fleet composition will be about 30% electric. And we were one of the first across the nation to make this commitment. And so, you know, again, I think that's important for us to show others, especially these customers who want to participate in Power My Fleet, that we're walking the talk.
And you guys have been on the cutting edge of that, right? With your coal announcement and now this announcement.
Yes.
You know, what does this state look like 5 years from now with the Ooh. Work that you guys are doing along with Ford and Chevy and the other OEMs that are putting these products out? What do you think the state looks like in 5 years?
Oh my gosh. That is a really great question. Here's what I think. I think we have been very progressive in the way that we think about clean energy and our ambition to be coal-free net zero by 2040. And then our recent filing of accelerating that to 2025, which is only 4 years away. And the way that we do that is we retire our whole coal fleet. And we instead of having coal, we now have a portfolio that's comprised of wind and solar and gas, and then customer programs such as energy efficiency and demand response. And then another component of that too is how we ensure that we can support this electrification, right, on the gas side of our business, because we have a similar ambition there. And so I think customers in 5 years, I could see clearly a lot more EVs on the road, and we're committed to that. We are working on a goal internally to put more vehicles, electric vehicles on the road. And we're thinking through what part of the value chain we as a utility can be a part of to help accelerate that adoption. And so we're exploring things like more in-home services, workplace charging, you know, school buses. We do think there's a great opportunity with school buses and public transit, which is typically large emitters of carbon, right? We're trying to figure out the role that we can play there. And I think it all kind of falls into, we clearly are experts in the utility industry, specifically with gas and electricity. And I think that we can help customers navigate what's required to ensure that they've got the proper infrastructure. They know how to make those upgrades. They can see the benefit of doing so, because when you go to plug in your electric vehicle today, even, but even more so in 5 years, you can rest assured that you're powering it with really clean energy, which I think is really important too, to think about. You know, the transportation sector, they are now the largest emitter of carbon. I think 40% of carbon comes from the transportation sector. And so if you think about, well, okay, I'm going to move to an electric vehicle and I'm going to plug my vehicle in. Am I helping the environment? Am I really helping create a sustainable future? You are, because the energy that you're getting from that plug, it is from really sustainable sources.
Lauren Youngdahl-Snyder, this has been an absolute blast. I cannot wait to do it again. Have an awesome time, and we will talk to you again soon.
All right. Thank you.